All right. Hi, I'm Astro, and I am concerned about the internet turning into a TV 2.0. And I don't mean this by convergence. It would be great if old media is being replaced by internet. But what worries me is concentration on very few service providers. And there's one area where this is very, very evident, and that is video on the web. There are two reasons for this. One is search. Google always tries to lure you into YouTube, which is different with BitTorrent because there are nice BitTorrent sites. And the second reason is traffic. Video data is huge, and if you've got a broad audience, your traffic demands are high and you need infrastructure. So it's worth to look away from classical client-server systems. And that's why today I want to talk about a fun side project of mine called Bitford, and I'm going to start with two related projects of mine. Then I'm going to introduce you to the BitTorrent protocol. Then I'm going to explain on the application model I choose. And then it's time for Bitford itself, and I hope the demo is going to work out. The majority of this talk will be about the lessons I learned during development, and then I've got a few platitudes about the future. So in 2010, I participated in the very first Node Knockout contest, which went over a weekend. And our idea was already to bring stream torrent data to the browser. And that works like this. You take a torrent file, you upload it to the web server, which is implemented in Node.js, and this takes care of the, this implements the BitTorrent protocol, requests all the data in order, and streams it directly to the browser, where it can be embedded for playback. That didn't work out that well because the time frame was very limited back then. It was just one weekend. And in general, it's a bad idea to do BitTorrent without any uploading. So this year, I learned AngularJS, and I did a little tool to help you share files. It creates torrents files completely in the browser. It runs client-side, so no data is being sent to any server about what you're wanting to share. I used DigestJS for SHA-1 hashing, and that yielded 2 MB/s on this laptop, which made me very confident about doing more BitTorrent in the browser. So why use BitTorrent? Because it's fast. Peers not only download, but also upload. And this is contrary to the classical client-server concept. The more people that are downloading, the faster it actually gets for everyone. Also because there are more than just the publisher who uploads data, the publishers actually save bandwidth. And because there are more hosts that upload, the infrastructure is much more redundant. BitTorrent also features integrity checks because you cannot trust random peers that send you data. More on that later. So how does it work? You've got a torrent file. You can download it from the web or send as an email attachment. They are very small. And you put it in your BitTorrent client. Now that client is going to contact the so-called tracker to obtain addresses of other peers who share the same data. And when you've got these addresses, you can connect to the other clients to actually share the data. And this is called the wire protocol. So these torrent files use a so-called B encoding, which is a structured data format. And what they contain is information about the layout of the data you want to download, which is like file names and file sizes. But it's uninteresting as because the data is treated as one contiguous chunk, which is divided by the so-called piece length. In this case, it's 256 kilobytes, which can be individually checked for their SHA-1 hashes, which are in this byte string. Now, if you take the encoded value of this info key, you get you hash that with SHA-1, you get your so-called info hash, which is the identifier for contacting the tracker, for talking with other peers. And that means you can exchange tracker URLs without creating a different torrent. It will still be the same swarm. So that makes it very great for peer-to-peer distribution of static data. And especially when I'm talking about streaming here, this is not about BitTorrent Live or BitTorrent Sync, which is a new system for live streaming and synchronization. But unfortunately, they are neither open source nor openly specified, so that's very sad. This is only about classical BitTorrent here. So the wire protocol is about requesting chunks of 16 kilobytes. This is not about transferring the whole pieces at once, but always about 16 kilobytes. And because this is such a small piece of data, you need pipelining. And this is my formula for this. This is basically you need to know how many pieces you have to request, or you have to have requested at a time. My formula is based on a simple bandwidth delay product over half a second with the current download rate. Why half a second? This is pretty much for today's internet connections. Well, I need to have that download rate go up in the first place. So let's get to Bitfort now. It's available on GitHub, and it currently implements the tracker requests, which classically run over HTTP. But nowadays, UDP trackers are much more popular because for the amount of data you're exchanging, UDP is much more lightweight. Peer connections, of course, because you want to exchange data. And there is a web worker process for hash checking the data in background, because that's quite CPU intensive. Also, I don't want to keep all data in RAM at all times, so I need persistent storage to disk. And because browsers feature great audio and video playback capabilities nowadays, I want to try media streaming. So the application model I needed, because I want to do TCP connections, are Chrome packaged apps, which give me more APIs. And there are three flavors of these. One is the classical extensions, which are intended to augment your browser with new functionality. And then you've got packaged and hosted apps, which have a different set of APIs, and they are made to resemble native apps. The difference between those is that packaged apps are installable locally, and hosted apps are always loaded from the network, so that's not very privacy friendly. So the API I needed is the Chrome Socket API, which is unfortunately only available to apps. So I couldn't do an extension to implement BitTorrent. On the other hand, I would really like to open a tab instead of a new window, but it's not available to packaged apps. And also, there's this integrated download manager in Chrome, but the API is way too limited anyway. So another problem with the APIs is, how do I intercept, for example, a click on a torrent file so I can actually start downloading the data, not only the torrent file, which is not possible using these APIs. There's a Chrome extension for embedding, for using PDF.js, and I saw one pull request that does it like that. They intercept HTTP requests, check the MIME type. If the MIME type matches, they redirect to their own viewer, to the PDF.js viewer, which then loads the PDF file for display. So this may be a way of doing it, but it's really not nice. So, and that's where we get to demo time now. I'm not heading over to Pirate Bay or something, but incidentally, I run a legal BitTorrent site. If you do, it's called bitlove.org. If you do know any podcasters, tell them to sign up. All they need to do is add their podcast feeds, and then it's fully automatic from there on. So let's look for some video content like this. And then we'll start Bitford. I made the UI a bit bigger. And what we can see here is that it has already connected to a few peers. Oh, great, we've got IPv6. And what it's doing, it's still requesting data randomly or based on rarity among the peers. Originally I implemented this to request data in a linear fashion, but if there were multiple clients that request data in a linear fashion, then piece distribution would become very uneven and the whole system would suffer. So this is surprisingly fast, but if I now press play, data is being requested at the very front because that's what the media element here is requesting, and it works. And seeking works too. And I seek there, and it's now loading from there. All right, let's get to some lessons I learned. So I need to do TCP connections, and therefore I need TCP client sockets. They're available on Firefox OS 2, but what's not available on Firefox OS is TCP server sockets, so I'm restricting myself to Chrome right now, because it wouldn't make sense implementing peer-to-peer applications without having server sockets. I also need UDP sockets because of the tracker protocol, and in the future I want to implement distributed hash table, tracker replacements, and the uTorrent protocol. So that is critical. Also, BitTorrent is a binary protocol, and I really don't want to get swamped into Unicode strings. And to me, very important is IPv6. I've been using this for like 11 years now because it fulfills the original promise of the internet, and that is full end-to-end reachability. If you've been looking for a killer app for IPv6, look no further. It is peer-to-peer. So Chrome Socket implements this, or provides this. There's no nice wrapping, but just methods and numerical socket IDs, which remind me of the POSIX file descriptors. But the API is asynchronous, so it does not block, which is nice. And you always deal with array buffers, the foundation for typed arrays, which is binary safe. So I created my own wrapping, which has a few helper methods for connecting out with a client socket, for creating a server socket that handles incoming connections with a callback. And because I do not want end users on a desktop to configure port numbers, I've got some guessing and retrying logic there too. BitTorrent is about high bandwidth of data, so I needed flow control, and that's why I replicated the pause and resume logic known from Node.js streams. And on the outgoing side, I've got the drain event that is only emitted when there's no further write pending. So in the future, we will have a nice encapsulation that is being standardized as the raw socket API, which is quite misleading because this is not about raw sockets, but still about TCP and UDP. So now that we can connect to peers, we need to think about network stream processing. These BitTorrent packets come in a TCP stream, but they are still packetized. So I need to find packet boundaries. And while the Chrome Socket API provides or accepts a buffer size when reading, I still want to be able to process a very contiguous stream. because one day I would like to implement the message stream encryption over the TCP stream, and there's this uTorrent protocol too, which uses UDP. So my approach is this. There is a kind of scheme to concatenate array buffers, which uses blobs and the FileReader API, but it's really slow, and in general, it is a good idea to avoid copying. So I'm taking a very, very old idea of a buffer list that encapsulates arrays of buffers. And I'm just rotating data through that buffer. I append it to the end and consume it from the front. So I've got this optimization with the buffer size for the read call, but that makes it much, much faster, but that could break the network streaming requirement. So now that we've implemented the BitTorrent protocol, I need a strategy to download for streaming purposes. And well, what I want to do is, when you go to YouTube, you just click and play, and ordinary BitTorrent clients just load till the end, and then you play. They do this with some standard techniques, like just requesting a piece from one peer. This has two reasons. One is data locality. Those data is being transferred in 16 kilobyte blocks, which is really small, and it's much more fun to do this on SSD than on rotational media. Also, if somebody sends you crap and the hash check fails, you can much easier isolate the liars that send you crap. So the exception to this is the so-called endgame mode, when you've got just a few pieces left that are queued at very slow uploaders. You can also request those pieces at these chunks at fast uploaders. And this is what Bitfort does all the time, so I can complete pieces faster, even before we're getting into endgame when the download is finishing. Also, a few clients do hash check only when all the data is available, which is really a limitation because we are living multi-core now, and we want to detect corrupt data much earlier. So we do this in the background with a web work process, and that allows us to be sure that this data is valid and we never deliver corrupt data to the media element. So now that data comes in, we need to store it away, and this took me really long to get right. Our requirements are random access to the 16 kilobyte chunks for writing and reading for uploading. And I don't want to have it all in RAM to avoid memory pressure, because having it all in RAM would be much easier. So my first approach was using the provided file system API, which was very naive. The provided sandbox file system is not the real file system, which would be useful to the user, to the end user, but an opaque database on the file system. And you cannot only iterate over files, but to satisfy the requirement of random access, you can read certain slices with offsets and lengths, and if you create a writer, you can seek to a position and write there. But I was still getting quite a lot of failed hash checks, and as it turns out, this does not seem to support sparse files files that have holes in them that are not yet written. So my second approach was like this. I keep the contiguous data together, but whenever there is a hole, I create a new file. And this looked like this in the progress graph. But I was still getting a lot of strange data races, and disk traffic with that API was a multiple of the network traffic that was coming in. So I restarted this from scratch and tried IndexedDB, which is another asynchronous API, so it's nice, it doesn't block like local storage. And all the examples talk about putting binary data in there, so it seemed like a good fit. The downside of this is you still, because this is not a contiguous chunk of data that you can access anywhere, the accesses need to be aligned along the 16 kilobyte limits. And something that was really important for me, especially as a developer, I would like to be able to free up disk space if the application crashed or something, and I need to find stale data. So IndexedDB provides three levels. There's the database, the object store, and the actual keys and values, and only at the very last level you can enumerate what else is there to clean up. So now comes the fun part, streaming into media elements. There's an API for that called the media source. And what you do is you create the media source, attach it to the media element here, and then you can just feed data into it. But these source buffers need to be aligned with the segments of the media container. So that would mean I need to implement like awk, MP3, MP4, Matryoshka, and I really, this is not the duty of this program. Why do we have to care? Because browsers deal with that segmentation already when you load data, when you load a video from HTTP, from the local hard disk, whatever. Attention, cheesy meme picture ahead. We can open TCP server sockets. So I just went ahead, took 20 minutes to implement a web server on localhost, and we pass it off to the media element, and the problem is solved. That just works. That should probably be replaced with a proper small web server, so you can open it up to the network, so you can perhaps pass the stream to a Chromecast device, something like that. Seeking support, if the user seeks in the media element, then the browser just sends HTTP range headers, and we can pass that to the pieces requesting logic. All right, that's almost it. I've got a lot of future ideas. Most importantly, user experience. I really need help there, because right now it's unusable. And also, there's this problem of handling the torrent files the user clicks on and registering, for example, a protocol handler for the magnet links. Also, because I run this BitLoft site, I want to integrate feed syndication, and that will enable a technology called broadcatching. And this will make it much more self-contained. You just get your feed with data, and you click on download and play, and it will just work. And I'm really looking forward to see Firefox OS emerge, so I'm waiting for more network APIs to become available there. I need TCP server sockets and UDP sockets. Perhaps that will come with the standardization of the raw socket API. And there are also more BitTorrent features I would like to implement, like proper upload scheduling, getting the data from HTTP for more robustness if there are no peers. Magnet links are really nice because you can share torrents with just a short string, which fits, for example, in a tweet. And the meta information data is being shared among the peers with the wire protocol. The distributed hash table eliminates trackers as a central point of failure. And the message stream encryption is not for privacy with random peers, but is very important for obfuscation when you have deep packet inspection and internet providers that throttle you. It is required in some setups. Also, what I found a really good idea is the uTorrent protocol, which has delay-based packet scheduling even before the buffer upload problem was recognized. So it's much more friendlier to other streams in the network, and that will improve on BitTorrent's reputation. So to finish up, peer-to-peer in the browser is possible, and if you do not need to rely on TCP sockets, but you can use WebRTC, then you don't even need a packaged app, but can do this in an ordinary web page. And that will allow us to get rid of the cloud. Because peer-to-peer lacks some trust, we don't have a central server you can trust, we need security, and we really need faster crypto APIs. And as I mentioned, we need more IPv6, and we need unmetered bandwidth, because nobody is going to share if they are watching their download volume. So thank you for listening, and this is where you can find the software.